Can you go to the floor slide?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Continue.
Okay. So, for the content, we were having introduction to the COVID-19. It will be the overview type. It will not be in the deep. And then symptoms, then digestive system damage and SARS-CoV-2. Then pathophysiologic mechanisms of GI symptoms of COVID-19 and diagnosis and prevention. So, introduction to the COVID-19. As you all know that COVID-19 was first reported in Wuhan, China in November 2019 and subsequently it is spread worldwide. Coronavirus patient zero, that means this first patient contracted case on November 17. It was the source from which it was obtained. This info was obtained. The novel human coronavirus, COVID-19, has become the fifth documented pandemic since the 1918 Spanish flu pandemic. The coronavirus was officially named Severe Acute Respiratory Syndrome Coronavirus, that is SARS-CoV-2, by the International Committee on Taxonomy of Viruses based on the phylogenetic analysis. And on the right-hand side, we can see that it was a Wuhan Institute. It is a Wuhan Institute of Virology of China. China takes WHO team to the Wuhan Bat Lab at the center of the coronavirus. Okay, history of coronavirus. Coronavirus is an RNA virus that is single-stranded and positive sense. And it is enveloped as was presented in the previous Saturday's presentations. It is a helical shape and it is from the family Coronaviridae. Okay, how many coronaviruses are there? There are large family of viruses that have been around for a long time. Many of them can cause a variety of illnesses. The new or novel coronavirus is one of the several known to infect humans. It's probably being found only around for some time in animals. Human coronavirus types. So scientists have divided the coronavirus into the subgroupings of four, that is alpha, beta, gamma, and delta. Then these were the seven viruses that can infect people, especially. And it has been obtained from the following source, webmed.com. Now, how COVID-19 affects the various body parts? It will be also an overview type. First of all, we can see in the lungs. A cross-section shows that the immune cells crowding an inflamed alveolus whose walls break down during the attack by the virus, diminishing oxygen uptake, patient's cough, fever rises, and it takes off more and more effort to breathe. And that is why they are having the respiratory problem during the COVID-19 effect. Now, second is liver. Up to half of the hospitalized patients have enzyme levels that signal a struggling liver. An immune system in overdrive and drugs given to fight the virus may be causing the damage. Third is kidney. Kidney damage is common in severe cases and makes the death more likely. The virus may attack the kidneys directly, or kidney failure may be part of whole body event like plummeting blood pressure. Fourth is intestine. Patient reports and biopsy data suggest the virus can infect the lower GIT, which is rich in ACE2 receptor. Some 20% or more of the patients have diarrhea. Now, COVID-19 effect on brain. Some COVID-19 patients have reported strokes, seizures, mental confusions, and brain inflammation. Doctors are trying to understand which are directly caused by the virus. effect on eyes, conjunctivitis, inflammation of the membrane that lines the front of the eye and inner eyelid is more common in the sickest patient. COVID-19 on nose. Some patients lose their sense of smell. Scientists speculate that the virus may move up to the nose nerve endings and damage cells. And then heart and blood vessels. The virus that is in the green enters the cell, likely including those lining blood vessels by binding to the ACE2 receptor on the cell surface. Infection can also promote blood clots, heart attacks, and cardiac inflammation. Now, the symptoms will be described by Ambika. Over to you. Sorry, Anand. Hello. Anand. Hello, am I audible?
Yes, yes, but Anand is not responding.
Okay, I shall continue then.
Okay.
Now, COVID-19 symptoms. COVID-19 affects not only the respiratory and the cardiovascular systems, but also to the central nervous systems and GIT. And in the further presentations, we'll relate the COVID-19 and the GIT system symptoms. GIT system and the symptoms of the GIT. Sorry. Now, most common symptoms would be fever, cough, tiredness, and loss of taste and smell. Respiratory manifestations such as cough, sputum production, and shortness of breath remain the most common symptoms, following fever or pneumonia. Then most of the patients do not present symptoms or are mildly symptomatic. Some people infected with SARS-CoV-2 that experience more severe multi-organ dysfunction. And here are the list of the less common symptoms, that is sore throat, headache, aches and pain, diarrhea, a rash on the skin or the discoloration of the fingers or toes, red or irritated eyes. Okay, some patients with COVID-19 had severe complications, including acute respiratory distress syndrome, cardiovascular conditions, multiple organ dysfunction syndrome, or septic shock. These complications are related to the release of cytokines and hyperinflammation or cytokine storm syndrome. So these are the symptoms that requires the immediate medical care. These are shortness of breath, difficulty in breathing, loss of speech or mobility, or mental confusion, and chest pain. GIT symptoms have early phase. In early phase of infection, where a high viral load induces intestinal problems. Intestinal dysfunction induces changes in intestinal microbes by activating intestinal ACE2 receptors and an increase in inflammatory cytokines and induces inflammation. Diarrhea may be secondary to the virus-induced inflammation, which in turn is due to the entry of inflammatory cells into the intestinal mucosa, including neutrophils and lymphocytes, and thus disruption of the microbiota. As the severity of the disease increased, GIT symptoms may become more pronounced. Then comes the progressive phase. In the second phase of the COVID-19, or a continuous phase where acute respiratory distress syndrome, that is ARDS, appears, the intestinal symptoms decreases, but the inflammation from the cytokine storm increases considerably. Intestinal damage can manifest after respiratory symptoms. Now, this will be explained by Ambika.
Thank you, Aditi. Now, I would like to explain about the digestive system injury and SARS-CoV-2 infection relation in it. As already Aditi mentioned, that there are a high number of ACE2 receptor in our gastrointestinal tract. Therefore, traces of SARS-CoV-2 RNA have been found in gastrointestinal cells. The digestive symptoms of COVID-19 likely occur because the virus enters the target cell through this ACE2 receptor, which is a known receptor for the virus. It is generally present in 100 folds higher than in the respiratory organs. Next slide. As per the clinical studies done in China, we can observe that as per this pie chart, 47% of the patient were observed with digestive and respiratory symptoms, and 41% of the patients were observed with respiratory symptoms but without digestive symptoms. This study was done in 74 patients, among whom approximately of 28% of the patient were observed with positive stool test, but their respiratory samples were presented to be negative. In addition, patients with these digestive symptoms took longer time to report for the medical care, hence took longer time for the recovery, and therefore it became critical generally in them. Next. Receptor-mediated signaling with gastrointestinal disorder. Like, based on the studies, as we already mentioned, that ACE2 receptors are highly present because of which gastric mucosa or gastrointestinal tract may be considered as vulnerable site for SARS-CoV-2 infection and is also the site of replication for the virus. The host receptor utilized by the SARS-CoV-2 is ACE2, sialic acid, and CD147 for the host cell infection. Human leukocyte antigen. It is an antigen which is present in our body, or we can say it is like a marker which distinguishes between the cells and non-self cells. Both the sialic acid and HLA are known to be important for Helicobacter pylori mediated gastritis and gastric cancer. It is the inflammation of gastric linings. Thus, they played an important role in causing gastrointestinal symptoms associated with COVID-19. Therefore, the person who is already suffering from Helicobacter pylori infection is more susceptible to getting infected with COVID-19. Now, I would like to hand over to Payal to proceed further.
Thanks, Ambika. Now we will discuss about the proposed pathophysiologic mechanisms for GI manifestations of COVID-19. Here we will discuss about the direct infection of GI cells, gastrointestinal damage caused by lung infection, and about the gastrointestinal symptoms caused by drug side effects. First of all, direct infection of gastrointestinal cells. Here we have already learned about the receptor on which the SARS-CoV-2 acts. Generally, the cross-species transmission occurs only when virus entry into the cells. So all coronaviruses encode a surface glycoprotein and spike protein, which binds to host cell receptors and mediates the virus entry. So SARS-CoV-2 enters cells primarily through the binding of protein S to ACE2 receptors to the infected cells and facilitate the replication part. ACE2 receptors, as we know, are present in different parts of our body. So here are some parts, epithelial cells in the lungs, small intestine and colon, tubular cells of the kidney, neuronal and glial cells in the brain, vascular endothelial cells. Next slide. So SARS-CoV-2 not only acts on the ACE2 receptors, but also on the receptors that are for transmembrane protease serine 2 an enzyme that is also expressed in the small intestinal epithelial cells to entry to the infected cells. So, and the co-expression of these two receptors are highest in the small intestine. ACE2, as we all know, that these are the enzyme which helps in the regulation of renin angiotensin system and plays an important role in regulating the intestinal inflammation and diarrhea. So loss of ACE2 leads to the angiotensin second accumulation and is associated with hypertension, diabetes, and cardiovascular problems, which we know are the major comorbidities of COVID-19. Although ACE2 knockdown results in elevated levels of ACE angiotensin second in the mouse colon, but ACE2 does not perform its function primarily through RAS system in the intestine, but rather directly regulates the homeostasis of intestinal amino acids, that is expression of antimicrobial peptides and ecology of gut microbiome. For instance, mice with ACE2 knockdown have significantly reduced the serum tryptophan levels. Tryptophan is essential for our niacin synthesis in the body. And insufficient intake of niacin or tryptophan is a main cause of pellagra. Accordingly, more than 90% of patients with pellagra will eventually develop colitis. Therefore, we speculate that binding of SARS-CoV-2 with ACE2 in the GI tract reduces the level available receptors, affects the absorption of tryptophan, and ultimately destroys the steady state of intestinal flora, which is one of the main causes of GI symptoms such as diarrhea. So, pathophysiological results showed that the cells which express ACE2 shows pro-inflammatory cytokines. But on the other hand, that doesn't express ACE2 receptors has no PIC, that is pro-inflammatory cytokines. So now we will discuss about gastrointestinal damage that is caused by lung infection. One study found that SARS-CoV-2 cannot always be detected in the stool of COVID-19 patients with GI symptoms. So we speculate that the GI symptoms of some patients may not be caused by direct damage due to the viral infection. So we are, here we study that gut-lung axis, that is SARS binds with the, in the next slide please. In the diagram, you can see the gut-lung axis. Here, the SARS-CoV-2 binds with the ACE2 receptor to enter the lung, resulting in accumulation of angiotensin second and decrease of angiotensin 1 to 7. Angiotensin second combined with angiotensin 1 receptor promote the cytokine release and increase the chemokine receptor 9 and CD4 plus T lymphocyte cells. CCL25 promotes the recruitment of chemokine receptor type 9 cells into the small intestine, leading to intestinal immune damage and destroying the homeostasis of intestinal flora. So here the change flora then promotes the polarization of Th17 cells and finally interleukin 17A causes the recruitment of neutrophils. Cytokines and bacteria also enters the lung through the bloodstream, further affecting the lung inflammation. So second one we will discuss here is gut-lung and gut-liver axis. Same with, here, SARS-CoV-2 binds with the ACE2 to enter the intestine, then inhibits absorption of ACE2 transport pathway and then affects the activation of mammalian target of rapamycin to reduce the expression of antimicrobial peptides. The intestinal flora is transferred to the liver through the portal vein, as you can see in the diagram, where it binds to the toll-like receptors. You can see the shape of the receptors also. This is the reason why hepatitis occurs. The liver also can transport the metabolites to the intestine through the biliary tract. So, last one is gastrointestinal symptoms caused by drug side effects. Antibiotic-associated diarrhea is the most common adverse reaction to the antibacterial drugs, especially macrolides, cephalosporins, and beta-lactam antibiotics. A retrospective analysis from China of the treatment process for 260 SARS-CoV patients found that macrolides, fluoroquinolones, or cephalosporin antibiotics were used and that the proportion of patients with diarrhea was 24.2%. So, antiviral drugs also cause diarrhea, including chloroquine phosphate, lopinavir, and remdesivir. So, we can conclude that the stated research above suggests that drug-induced diarrhea caused by the large-scale use of antibacterial drugs and antiviral drugs is also one of the causes of GI symptoms in some patients. So, now Tanya will tell you about the diagnosis and preventive measures. Over to you, Tanya.
Diagnosis of SARS-CoV-2 in GI. SARS-CoV-2 can be detected in the stool of some patients for greater than 4 weeks, suggesting that stool may hold utility as an additional source for diagnosis. In most recent studies, looking at 73 patients, approximately 24% remained positive in their stool for evidence of the virus, though not necessarily infection, after showing negativity in respiratory samples. Many doctors recommend that real-time reverse transcriptase polymerase chain reaction testing for severe acute respiratory syndrome coronavirus 2 from feces should be performed routinely in SARS-CoV-2 patients. Now, what is RT-PCR? It involves the reverse transcription of SARS-CoV-2 RNA into complementary DNA strands, followed by amplification of specific regions of the cDNA. The design process generally involves two main steps, sequence alignment and primer design, and second, assay optimization and testing. Assessment by polymerase chain reaction has provided evidence of the virus in the stool and the oropharynx outside the naropharynx and respiratory tract. Virus in the stool may be evident on the presentation and last throughout the course of illness resolution for up to 12 days after the respiratory virus evidence is gone. Next slide. Now, what if you already have gastrointestinal disorders? People with some gastrointestinal disorders like inflammatory bowel disease are at an increased risk of developing some types of viral infections. According to researchers, the precautions to be taken by the people with IBD include frequent hand washing, covering your face when coughing and sneezing, avoiding people with flu-like symptoms, staying at home when possible. Some of the medications used to treat IBD may suppress the immune system. So, if a person with IBD has tested positive for COVID-19, he or she should speak to the doctor about what medications should be taken. Next slide. Now, general preventive measures. Transmission of severe acute respiratory syndrome coronavirus 2 infection is thought to mainly occur through respiratory droplets transmitted from an infectious person to those within 6 feet of the person. So stay 6 feet apart. Second, wash your hands or use hand sanitizer before putting on your mask. If you have to continually adjust your mask, it doesn't fit properly and you might need to find a different mask type or brand. Make sure you can breathe easily. If soap and water are not readily available, use a hand sanitizer that contains at least 60% alcohol. Cover all surfaces of your hands and rub them together until they feel dry. Avoid touching your eyes, nose, and mouth with unwashed hands. Avoid crowds. The more people you are in contact with, the more likely you are to be exposed to COVID-19. So, the risk of SARS-CoV-2 transmission can be reduced by covering cuffs and sneezes and maintaining a distance of at least 6 feet from others. So act now, wear a mask, stay 6 feet apart and avoid crowds. Thank you.
Any questions, guys? Okay, Payal, Aditi, and other team members, good efforts and nicely presented, but you took a bit long time. And I am happy that you have included the references in the bottom, but in some cases, they were missing, especially from Payal's presentation. So
I have included in the last of my topic.
Yeah,
there was there written as a copyright type.
Sorry, what was copyright?
Copyright? Ma'am, it was written at the bottom or the last of the slide. Of Payal's slide, I mean.
Okay, that's fine. So, can you send me that presentation?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so mail me and I request all the other team members, please send me your presentation you have presented. And I have already prepared one.